time, and Mary has chosen the better part. And finally, from our epistle lesson for today, I chose that epistle lesson to be our affirmation of faith from Colossians. Christ is before all things, and in him all things hold together. All things hold together. All things hold together. This morning we're going to do a little Bible study first, if that's okay. And then if you will allow, I would like to give you a bit of the gospel according to Tupper, which of course is a scary thing for you, and certainly a scary thing for Tupper, because Tupper knows that he's not that wise. And he wants the gospel that he gives to be the Lord's gospel, the Lord's good news, and not his own, because Tupper has no good news. No gospel that is not the Lord's good news, but that I'm sure. On the other hand, any preacher takes the gospel given and tries to preach it. Which, by the way, you should remember when you in the years to come, it's not that easy to do. Any preacher takes the gospel and tries to preach it. That is, any preacher worth their salt takes it and lets it stew in him or her and in their mind and consciousness and heart and pray over it and study it and then give it back in his or her own words. So any sermon is not just a reflection of the words on the page, but also a reflection of the one giving, for better or worse. And truly, it is also a reflection of the ones hearing it, whether they hear it at all, and whether their ears and their hearts are open, and how they hear it through the Lord's presence, and how different they are, and how different their hearts and ears may be. So we hear different things. Isn't that interesting? It's a strange, strange way to make a living. The hope is that there will be heard in the words, that the Lord's gospel will be heard in Tupper's gospel, that we will hear the word within the words spoken. Hear the word with a capital W within the words, and then the word is spoken. Again, remember that when you're tempted to criticize a preacher, even those who want nothing more than to be faithful to the gospel must put it in words. Okay. Even when we read the words of the gospel, say of Luke, our task, not just the preachers, is to find the word, capital W, within the words, little W, of the text. What is God trying to say to us in this text? What did it mean to those who first heard it from the lips of Jesus or from the pen of Luke? What is God trying to say to us? Does it mean something different to those of us in Salem, Virginia in 2022 than it did, let's say, in Cappadocia in 87 AD? I suppose it does. If you look at the familiar readings, which are our gospel lessons for this and last week, you will note that the story of Mary and Martha is placed by Luke where? Story of Mary and Martha, the sisters. Where is it placed? Well, it's placed immediately after the story of the young warrior with the question about eternal life and the limits of loving the neighbor. Mary and Martha occur immediately after the parable of the Good Samaritan leads the lawyer and us with the unsettling notion that to love and serve my neighbor has no that it needs to love and serve the person, any person who we find is in need, however inconvenient serving that needy person might be. That's a difficult word to hear. And the reader who is searching, as all true readers of the Bible are, to search for the word within the words of God to them, God's plan and intention for them, God's purpose and calling for them, is left after reading this text, the text with the Good Samaritan, with the natural impression that God, what God wants for us, as expressed in these teachings of Jesus, is that we should have our eyes wide open as we travel life's road. We individually, we as a congregation, we as a people, our eyes wide open as we travel life's road, open for the man in the ditch, open for the one who has been beaten and needs to be mended. Open for the one who has been passed by and needs someone to care, to do for him or her, to extend what is necessary to be an agent of God's neighborly care. Eyes open and hearts open, and yes, wallet open. Love God and love neighbor is expressed in action, in service, in sacrifice for the one in need. And if we read this text, we might conclude that anything less is hypocritical religious posturing, rationalization for our tendency to cross by on the other side. Right? Seems to be the word. But then old Luke chooses to drop Mary and Martha. Man. A story in which the one who serves Martha is gently judged by our Lord for being too concerned and distracted by all the serving, doing, hosting, sacrifice, table setting, blind pouring, dishwashing. Too distracted by serving to attend to the teaching of our Lord. Mary, who Martha thinks quite reasonably has shirked her duties to serve and show hospitality, has made, according to Jesus, a better choice. She has chosen to sit at his feet and listen. She has chosen devotion. We don't like this story much, do we? I can decide with Martha, don't you? Look, you've got your practical people. We admire hard work and action. And we're not lazy people. And sometimes we think that people who sit monk-like and listen to a teacher are really lazy. We prefer Martha to Mary. And frankly, we prefer the Good Samaritan too, hard as he is to emulate. Now, the reader who is searching for God's word to them, God's plan to them, God's intention to them, God's calling to them, reads the story of Mary and Martha, and only if you read only that story, and comes away with the natural impression that what God wants for us, as expressed in these teachings of Jesus, is that we should spend our days in focused devotion. Our job is to sit at the feet of Jesus and listen to his words. Listen as we go through our days to his voice in the everyday. Listen as we spend great swaths of time in study of the scriptures. Listen as we spend time and energy in prayer and meditation and devoted contemplation of Christ. Shut out the distractions of the world. Shut out the obligations of culture and tradition. Single-minded devotion. Anything less is busyness and doing without connection to the source of love, that which is needful, the Christ. That's the word, right? Does anyone ever get confused when you read this book? Now, the gospel according to Tupper, let me offer an alternative. Suppose we assume that the life and teachings of Jesus as presented in Luke's gospel are really meant to be by the Spirit of Christ, God's word to us. Let's just suppose that. Let's start there. From which we are to understand something of God's intention for us as individuals and people. From which we hear God's call to us if we have ears to hear and are willing to listen and willing to change, willing to be changed, transformed. It might be true that the Word of God can be found not only in and amongst the words, but perhaps in the form in which the words come to us. In other words, maybe in these two stories with their apparent contradictory meanings, God is saying to us something simply by their proximity. That our worth up for a moment with me, it seems that even religious life boils down to the management of these choices to pick up sides. I can wrong. I can cry. Conservative and liberal. Democrat and Republican. Gospel of social justice. Gospel of salvation and the forgiveness of sins. Those who see the church as standing against the world, and those who see the church as standing for the world, those who see purity, those who see peace, those who feel inclusion and tolerance are the hallmarks of Christian love, and those who emphasize right doctrine and right behavior according to our way of thinking about it. I'm not saying that these distinctions are not real or unimportant. Of course they are, but our insistence upon their primacy for our identity as human beings is a denial of God's intent. Our insistence on the dividing of purpose and even our persons and even ourselves along these fault lines is utterly un-Christian. We are different people. Some of us are more inclined to be Mary. Some of us are more inclined to be the Good Samaritan. We have different ministries and different proclivities and different political persuasions. But let us be done with the dualism of our day. Let the church be the one place where we let those false dichotomies, where we set them aside for the unifying purpose of what is it? Love God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and your neighbor. And if we don't get rid of our insistence on identifying ourselves by something other than Christ, well, it'll be no wonder that everybody's head in this room is gray. Well, not everybody. There'll be no wonder that we will watch our democracy and our republic swing around the drain and go. Well, I've gone on long enough, but I have not more things to say. Finally, I want to speak of one more dualism that is at the heart of all. One more dichotomy. It is assumed by most of us who call ourselves Christian, but not by our Lord. It is a dualism that is part of Western civilization. It is a dualism that is part of my heart. It is a dualism that we are bequeathed by the Enlightenment, but not by our Lord. It is the separation of the sacred from the mundane. From the time we were children, we were taught, this is church, this is the workplace. This is business, this is religion. This is politics, this is faith. This is the world, this is the spirit. I believe that this is the greatest challenge facing the church, the source of the disconnect most of us feel between real life and faith. Here, this, my friends, the whole world is the Lord's world. The world is God's. may sound crazy, but it is the truth of all truths. It is the deep water in which Christ calls us. May we, you and I, all of us together, be transformed every day more and more into His image and know joy and life and fun and heartache as His own. Our hymn is number 702.
We return to God, partial of the gifts He has given us. We pray that they will be used according to His will. And also the support of these young folks going to country. All these things we ask in our Lord and Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Especially since it's been so unexpectedly long and through the trying circumstances of a COVID-19 pandemic. From the moment you arrived to the man here, you have provided exemplary leadership in every conceivable area of our church, whether it be in your stimulating and thought-provoking sermons, your polished skills as a moderator of session, your deft teaching displayed in your many community Bible study, your terrific Tupper Talk monthly submissions to Tower Talk, your warm-hearted forging of friendships as you administer to our needs, and last, but certainly not least, your keen insight as to how structural changes in our church government could, would, and have improved our effectiveness as a caring congregation in a troubled world. As you start a 6-week vacation where you and Virginia will begin the process of moving into a beautiful, newly constructed home in Florida, we want to wish you all the best in this well-deserved time off. Well deserved, in that you've not had an extended vacation since your arrival. And in this light, we would like to present to you, as a token of our deep appreciation and gratitude, the gift of an American basswood tree. Your favorite gift for planting on your property in Floyd in hopes it will bring you pleasant memories of a time well spent with a loving and appreciative congregation. In lieu of, and as a symbol of the tree, due to arrive in September, by the way, we present to you a pint container of basswood honey. Your illustrious 37 plus years ministerial